He's been a visiting professor at the Bolivia Marina for the past 3 months, where he's been three manuscripts submitted, and we explored a lot of places all over Bolivia. Klaus has also been busy monitoring movies and sea urchins that he was having. Apart from that, he also taught a course, right? So I think some of you took his fish class. And then we had a lot of fun also learning to dive in the house. So, yes. Okay, so anyway, let's give Klaus a very warm welcome.
So thank you for having me, and you know, really let me start at the beginning with the acknowledgement. So many thanks to Cecilia and Patrick and Ando for bringing me to Bolivia, which was really, there was, as Cecilia said, it was very productive because lots of really smart people to talk to, nice resources, and you know, close to 0% of my time spent with administration, and that's a rare state of being for the researcher. So I would like to talk about a project which I finished in Bolivia, and I started that with People and the Sea, which is a very nice environmental NGO which is based in Malapaspa in the Cebu province, and they do community outreach, they do reef monitoring, and they're also interested in doing science. And when I got there, their science officer, Clint Barrett, said, well, you know, why don't we look at this interesting phenomenon of these, you know, of sea urchin behavior. And that works. Yeah. So we were studying sea urchins and oops, no, it does. These animals, as you probably all know, they are the echinoderms, they are marine grazers and sometimes detritus feeders. And the interesting thing about echinoderms in general, about sea urchins especially, is they have this skin which is covered in these really interesting appendages. So I shot a couple of videos, and both in Malapascua and in Bolinao in the field, as well as in the tanks of the MSI. So let me go through these appendages by showing you the video. So has anybody stepped on a sea urchin ever before? Yeah, so you know that you know the first type of appendage already, of course. So this is a, you can see all the spines on this Salmacis, which is, that's important now. And it's, of course, it's a time lapse. So then, you know, so basically here you have these 2 feet, you know, very interesting, you know, appendages of the animal. You see how long this one can stretch. So what these are, they're part of a hydraulic system. So they're filled with essentially a filtered version of seawater. The ionic composition is not exactly the same. And they are both longitudinal muscles as well as circular muscles. So they can use these 2 feet to grab objects. Here this individual of Salmacis is grabbing the wall of the fish tank. And as you can see in them, there are these discs on the tip of the 2 feet. So what the discs are, they are multimodular sensory organs. So there are these ciliated cells, which are olfactory receptors, so it's basically the nose of the sea urchin. Because of this, they can sense the amount of pull, so there is also mechanoreception, and in the discs there is expression of some opsin and PAX6 proteins, which are proteins which in invertebrates are expressed in the eye, And it has actually been shown that these photoreceptors are photosensitive. So what this is, basically, it's an arm with a nose and an eye integrated. And the urchins have, you know, hundreds to a thousands of them. So, and you know, there are, you know, different species, there is some work on the visual acuity, so they can see about 10 degrees, which, so you could think of it as a 36, you know, a circle obviously has 360 degrees, so that they could see 36 pixels all around them. So it's a very wide-angle, the whole urchin is one eye, which doesn't have a great resolution, but it's still, it's capable of seeing its environment. So all of this happened, yes, you know, number two. So you see the pedicillage. So there are these tiny, tiny claspers here. Can you see that? So what happens in sea urchin evolution is that four individual spines fused, and the motor control of these spines also fused, and then these grasping apparatuses are formed. And there are at least four different types. There's some which are scrapers, which remove bacterial film from the surface of the sea urchin. Some are actually venomous. So there are venom glands, and then the tip of the pedicellaria looks like a hypodermic needle. So basically, what the, you know, if a predator or if a parasite approaches the urchin, it would inject them with a venom, and that's also a type of pedicellaria. And there are two different classes which are essentially claspers. So if a predatory animal, maybe a starfish or a fish, tries to harm the sea urchin, they can pinch them with that. And so these are really interesting structures here as well. And you also see, obviously, you know, some of you have made personal contact with the spines already. So you see the spines. And the spines are not like a thorn on a plant. But in fact, what you can see quite well here is that they move. So the spines are elevated. There are nerves running up and down the spine, and there is a muscle at the base of the spine. So they can change the direction. There's also something that's unique to echinoderms, which is called a catch apparatus. So there is a type of connective tissue at the base of the spine, which receives input from the nervous system, and then if the input is strong, this catch apparatus stiffens. So it's a connective tissue with variable stiffness. So it can really pull in one direction, but it can resist pull, you know, stronger or weaker, depending on how much nervous system input is coming in. Now, all of these appendages act in a semi-independent manner, which is very interesting to me. If you think about any type of vertebrate, could be a human, it could be a mouse, the nervous system acts in a way that you have all the sensory organs, you know, the eyes, ears, nose, they collect information from the environment. That information ends up in the brain, and then there's a motor output. So there's a central spot for the integration of information, which is the brain. And then, you know, There's a centralized output system. So there are very few cases where, you know, human legs act independently. There's this reflex, right? But normally, in the vast majority of cases, there is, you know, a brain, which is it's 1.5 kilos out of 80 kilos, gives the commands to the rest of the body. Not so in these animals. Very interesting. If you cut out a little piece of sea urchin skin, you would still get, obviously, I mean, the metabolic energy supply wouldn't work after a while, but for many minutes, these organs would independently do what they were doing in the intact animal. So there's only a very diffuse nerve net underneath the skin, which coordinates these organs, and then there is only a very primitive central nervous system, which is a ring around the mouth, and there are five radial nerves which go up the body. And from this radial nerve, this network originates. So basically what this animal is, it's a highly intelligent skin, and each little patch of skin acts independently. And it's really interesting to me. Now you can you guess what this is? I was just talking about it. Any suggestions? No? It's the mouth, right? So this Saramacis was feeding on the wall of the fish tank. And then, you know, these animals have a five-fold body symmetry. So here you can see five teeth, and it's grazing on the wall. Not all five teeth are out at the same time. And you know, here there's another close-up of the spines. So you can see very well how they change angle. In some species, they bundle together. And there's something very interesting which they do, which is some of these species cover themselves with material which they find in the marine environment. So this is a piece of Sargassum seaweed, and you can see that the tube feet they're pulling, so the suction disc, you know, can generate a slight under pressure so that it can hold onto things and it's pulling. And you can also see that the spines are kind of pushing it up. So essentially what they're doing, you know, the spines part, and then from below they push up the debris. So this is a coordinated action, you know, of tens of tube feet together with tens of spines. Let's watch that a little bit. So that, you know, this was shot with Patek's TG4 camera, which is a fantastic camera if you want to do, you know, close-up videography like this. So you can see that they're, you know, the spines kind of push, and the spines part in front of the object, and then behind it here, you know, the spines stabilize and push, you know, the piece of seaweed up. Now, why do you think they know? They've heard parts of the talk before. Why do you think the sea urchins are doing this? Well, there are actually several reasons. And one is UV protection. So these animals live in rather shallow water sometimes. So in Borinau, we at this one site, which many of you probably know, in Silaki, the water is only about 2 meters deep. And then with the clear water in the tropics, with strong sunlight during the middle of the day, you will get a lot of UV. And so they cover themselves with seaweed and with coral rubber in order to, you know, as a sunscreen. Another reason why they're doing this is, so here that's in the field, two urchins are kind of wrestling over one piece of seaweed. Very interesting, huh? Another reason, yeah, see, this is another, you know, I don't know whether, so you see more covering material here, more covering material here. This, it also weighs them down in the face of surge. So if there's strong water movement, the urchin wants to stay in place, and they just become heavier with that. And another reason, and we're actually in the process, I hope, of testing that it's anti-predatory, which has been shown for spider crabs in a temperate water species of sea urchin. We test this with the helmet snails, which prey upon sea urchins. And so here you already see some of this loading behavior. There's one more possible reason for the covering behavior, which is just food storage. So this is obviously, this is coral rubber, and so obviously they are not able to feed on that, but this type of sargassum and the seaweed, they can eat. So it has been suggested by several workers in the field that it would just essentially increase their range if they bring a snack. And so let me show you some more. So these are time-lapse recordings. And I actually stripped this urchin of debris, and you see how quickly they cover themselves. So I was very surprised when we investigated that first. Within less than 10 minutes, if you use this, you know, barbecue prongs, I took off all the debris. Within less than 10 minutes, they were completely covered again. So they really don't feel very comfortable if they're without debris. So here there's another close-up. This is a different species. This is Deipnoistes gratina. And again, you see there's the pushing movement by the spines and the 2 feet are pulling it up. And this is basically, this is an initial stage of the covering behavior where the spines are not involved yet, but the 2 feet are grabbing the material. So this is another example of a flower urchin. This urchin is actually quite dangerous. So these are Pedicellariae, which have a venom which can be quite toxic even to humans. So, you know, another example where the urchin is very eager to cover itself. So, this is what we investigated. And we looked at 4 species, and which are Deipnoistes, Pteridophora, Toxopnoistes, and Salmacis. This you can find in Cebu and in Borinau. This I've only seen once in Borinau, but it's very common in Malapascua. This I've seen only once in Malapascua, but it's very common in Borinau. And this I've never seen. Has anybody seen that one? It's kind of not an ideal picture because it's covered so well. So these species I've only seen in Malapascua. So quite interesting, really, to me, that you move for a couple hundred kilometers and the fauna changes quite a bit. So we looked at a couple of things. And foremost, we looked at what was it which they used to cover themselves. And so these are the species. I apologize for the small font. So this is the Deipnoistes, the Salmacis, the Pseudopolini, and the Toxopnoistes. And blue is simply coral rubber. And these, so red are shells, purple are algae, and green is seagrass. So if we just take all of these types of debris and split them into 2 categories, and one being essentially dead calcified shell material, so either coral rubber or shells, and the other part being organic material, we can see that the Deipnoistes and the Salmacis have a much stronger preference for organic material. So, and if you're in Silaki the next time, pay attention. Like you will only very rarely see Salmacis with coral rubber on top of themselves. So, different species of sea urchin have a very strong preference for different types of covering material. We also looked at the type of coverage. So, this is the coverage area in square centimeter against the depth at which we found these animals. Now, this was only significant for the toxopnoisters. This is this, the flower urchin, right, with these little discs, the dangerous one. And because unfortunately we didn't have a lot of samples of deeper depth for all the other species. In toxopnoisters, what we found is that the deeper you go, the less coverage material there is. Why would that be the case? Well, you know, that if it's UV protection, the deeper you go, there's less UV, there's less need. So we've now seen that not only do different species prefer to have different types of coverage material, but they also adjust what they put on their bodies depending on the situation. There is some work showing that some species also drop parts of the covering material at night. Also makes sense, right? Less, obviously, no UV light at night, and so they need less protection. That's also something I've seen with the urchins which we had in the hatchery in Borinau. So the point of all this is that the urchins, you know, this is not just random stuff which gets stuck on them, but it's a very, it's a conscious decision by the urchin, depending on species and situation, what to use. There was really no dependence on the number of fragments and the size and the weight of the fragments as a function of the diameter of the urchins. But again, if we look at the four different species which we studied, there's quite a difference in the average weight which the urchins were putting on top of themselves. And then the cake urchin and the flower urchin, the pneusters and the toxopnoisters, they use much heavier fragments. And the salmases, which were the ones where I showed you the close-ups before, they used really light fragments. So, you know, I think it's, another thing which we did, we looked at the transport speed. So we used this software, we talked about this software with Patrick and Cecilia. It's quite useful, it's called Trekker. It's a freeware, and so you basically, you play a video, and then you point the mouse at, you know, your object of interest. And then it automatically traces where that goes. So what I did, I had this recording of this flower urchin from above, and then I clicked at the point of a fragment which was the closest to the dorsal pole of the urchin. And so basically this is the center of the coordinate system, and then it picked up something from here, and then it moved it up. Now these are the four different species, and there is no clear trend. So as I've shown before, that the type of, the mechanism of how they move the objects on top of the body is very similar between different species. Also the speed is, and you see these episodes of fast movement and then nothing happens for a while. If there's a pointed piece of coral rubber, for instance, they prefer to orient it before they move it. So it's, you know, there's quite a, They don't want to lift something like this. They turn it first, and then they lift it like that. So all of this, I think, shows that this is, this is not a random process. This is a process which is quite sophisticated, and it's quite distinct between species and situations. One more thing that's interesting to me is this probably evolved at least four times independently. So, you know, now I'll give you like a 45 seconds quick introduction into sea urchin evolution. So you probably know about the end-Permian extinction. So before the time of the dinosaurs, 250 million years ago, over 90% of all marine species died out. And it was probably global warming. But back then, because of huge volcanoes in what's now Siberia. So, you know, the oceans became anoxic, and, you know, the only thing which survived in terms of sea urchins were animals which are similar to the pencil urchins. Are you familiar with these? So these are global urchins with rather thick spines, so that they look like the spines are, you know, not like in the diatoma, they're actually like thin pencils, basically. And then from that, what evolved were first animals like, you know, these black urchins with the long spines, the diatoma, a number of other urchins, which, you know, include all the four species which we looked at. And actually, the majority of living sea urchin species, which that also surprised me very much to read that, are sand dollars and their relatives. So sand dollars, they have lost their five-fold symmetry. They are the secondarily two-fold symmetric. And they have really specialized feeding adaptations so that they can feed on detritus. The primitive urchins don't cover themselves, and the sand dollars, they're often under the sand, they don't cover themselves. But in these other lineages, you know, there are at least four separate branches with species in between where I could not find, so this is both the observations in our study as well as the literature survey. I could not find covering behavior for all of these other urchins in between. And the last common ancestor of all covering urchins is 12 million years old. So these are animals which are less related to each other than us to any other mammal. So, you know, these are quite distinct lineages which independently evolve. So here comes the big question. And it's fun to look at in time lapse. There are definitely interesting ecological aspects of it, but is it tool use? And I think tool use is a very, that's a very, one of these holy grails, right? If you, for a species. And you know, like, what if we, like as humans, we use tools all the time, right? Like each of you has like writing utensils in front of you. You know, you get up, you pour water in a cup and drink it, right? The cup is a tool, you know? And because humans are such extreme tool users, you know, up until probably 70 or 80 years ago, biologists would say, well, you know, tool use is what separates the fantastic humans and the lowly animals. And that changed this attitude. So, you know, you know this lady? Yes. And she was really instrumental in bringing about this change in attitude. So, I mean, obviously, there's a chimpanzee, juvenile chimpanzee, and she was studying these animals for many years in the field in, I think, Tanzania, right? And so the chimpanzees use tools in a number of ways. So, for instance, they would take a little stick and fish for termites, which have a very high nutritional value. So they basically, they would first have to find a proper stick, they would modify the stick, and then they would use it properly. And so this was not a circus trick. This was not something which somebody taught the chimpanzees for like, human enjoyment. This was something which happened in the field, you know, without any human intervention. And so, you know, that became accepted. But still, you know, I mean, a chimpanzee is what, I think it's 10 million years removed from us. So, you know, these are some of our closest living relatives. But then, you know, recently there has been a lot of work on these crows, which are also tool users in the field. So, you know, that's already an organism that's much more distinct from us. Invertebrates use tools. So I took this picture in Japan. This is obviously a hermit crab, which had grown out of this small shell, and it moved into the larger one. So again, there's a choice of an object, and you know, a use of that object for goal-directed behavior. It's very hard to argue that that is not tool use. This picture I'm really excited about. I found that in Sydney, in New South Wales. So obviously it's an octopus, which uses an aluminum can lid as kind of a protective shield in its burrow. Now, you know, it's very interesting that, you know, aluminum now is produced with an electrolytic process. before that was discovered, there were a few decades where it had to be molten out of the ore. And at that point, that process was so much more complicated that aluminium was more expensive than gold. So the Emperor of France had an aluminium table set for special occasions. And that was, I think, in the 1830s. And this octopus now, you know, has stuff which like 150 years ago only the Emperor of France had. So, you know, obviously that's a human artifact, but there are many nice cases of the octopi use coconut shells, which obviously occur naturally, again, as a protective shield. And they would sometimes, they would bring the coconut shell. When they're moving over the sand, you know, they would bring the armor with them. So again, you can, I think it's hard to argue that this is not tool use. So we have chordates, vertebrates, the first phylum. We have arthropods, insects and crustaceans. We have mollusks, the cephalopods, and then the question is, echinoderms, the fourth tool-using phylum. So normally it's bad practice, I think, to have a slide with a lot of text, but that's an exception. So this is a definition of tool use, which it essentially evolved over time. And you have to include enough things so that it doesn't become arbitrary. You have to exclude things that it doesn't become meaningless. And so, you know, this definition from 2008 is tool use is the exertion of control over freely manipulable external objects with the goal of altering the physical properties of another object, substance, surface, or medium. And that might be the tool use. So if you stick something on top of yourself so that you're harder to be eaten, or you know, that you're camouflaged, you know, that you're weighted down in this phase of search. That's included here. Or, number two, mediating the flow of information between the tool user and the environment, or other organisms in the environment. Flow of information is being seen. So if you camouflage yourself, and that's really what these salmacis do, that's also tool use. So I think it's, there, we have two options. I think we can, at this point, we can say yes, echinoids, sea urchins are tool users. I mean, there's with this definition, which is the pretty much a consensus definition in the literature, there is really no way of calling these animals not tool users. We can then, you know, apologize for underestimating these animals for so long. The second thing we could do is we could say, well, we are not comfortable with the notion of this behavior being tool use, and we will modify the definition. You know, it seems a little bit like being a bad sport, right? You know, basically that you lose and then you change the rules. But there is actually a fundamental difference between tool use and sea urchins and, for instance, a ape or us. Now, this is the result of a functional magnetic resonance imaging study. What this is, obviously our blood carries oxygen. If it carries oxygen, the magnetic properties are a little bit different. So you can measure these magnetic properties in an intact living human, and then you can, at a very good spatial and temporal resolution, and the spatial resolution is about a cubic millimeter. And then, so you can do that in the brain. Now, if you have areas where all of a sudden the magnetic signal changes in a way as if there was less oxygen, you know that this brain region uses more oxygen. So these are scans of brains of, you know, living humans. You don't have to open up the skull. You know, you can essentially actually volunteer for quite a lot of these studies as a graduate student. So I have pictures of my own brain, which I think is really cool. And then, so this is a study where people, where they were comparing actual tool use with random hand movements. And then they were subtracting the random hand movements from the tools, and then they had the brain regions which were specific for tools. On the top, this is the planning of tools, and this is the actual execution of tools. This is a human brain looking this way and this way. And this is the left hemisphere and this is the right hemisphere. So basically this is the identical brain, but you know it's plotted twice, once from this side and once from this side. And so basically the spinal cord would be connected here. Now, you have all these here, you have all these, that's the motor cortex. That's basically the area which you know, executes motor commands. This is the prefrontal cortex, and that is a planning area. So what we have here in this human is a central nervous system representation of tools. So these people, they use the tool and they understand what they're doing. They have some concept of what the tool is going to achieve and how it will extend the capabilities of their body. I'm pretty sure the same thing happens in a chimpanzee. A chimpanzee brain is essentially a downscaled human brain. Probably pretty similar things will still happen in crows, and at least qualitatively similar things, and I can only speculate here, there's absolutely no data about that, will happen in octopi and in crustaceans. All of these animals have a brain. They have a central nervous system. The echinoderms just have this diffuse skin, and you know the emergent behavior of the skin leads to behavior, which I think is tools, 100%. But there's no understanding, and not even at the most primitive level of what they're doing. So if we want to draw a line between vertebrate insects and octopus tools and what the sea urchins are doing, I think the absence of a central representation of tools would be the that would be the line we could draw. Now, I hope you enjoyed that. Now, for something completely different. So what I just talked about, we just submitted that and. So we just completed the manuscript. This is a new project which which I started in Berlin now with great help from a number of people. Natto, if any of you know him, he was very helpful. So this. Is a study of a symbiosis between a small fish, a goby, and a crustacean, a shrimp. Whereas the shrimp digs a burrow, and the burrow serves as a safe haven for both the shrimp and the goby. As you can see, the eyes of the shrimp are very small. The shrimp doesn't see very well. So any approaching predator would have an easy time with the shrimp. But the goby, for such a small fish, actually has quite large eyes. And the goby sends tactile warning signals, basically a tail wagging, to the shrimp. If a predator approaches, the goby would, in this way, tail the shrimp, and they would both disappear underground for a couple of minutes till the predator has hopefully left. Now, this symbiosis has been known, I think, since the 60s, but I think there are still a lot of open questions. So what we did, we shot these videos. Now, this is not easy to see. There's a goby here, and a shrimp here. I'm gonna... So you see the shrimp digging here? And you see that these two black dots, these are the eyes of the goby. Makes a lot of sense, right? It's not doing this to annoy the marine biologists, but you know, avoid getting eaten. And we have hours and hours of this footage now. And so basically there is a lot still to do. So You know, we're looking for help. Patrick volunteered to be an advisor for this project. If any student would like to work on this with us, what we essentially did is we put stationary cameras like this. So we have two GoPros here at the sand level. We have one GoPro facing down. That's the recording you just saw. And because these fish are so freaky, that if you are actually staying there as a diver, your presence, and especially actually the exhausts, bubble noise, will scare them. So, you know, this picture before, that was very difficult to take. And what we did, we just put these cameras there for typically an hour and a half a piece, and then we just left. And while the principle of the symbiosis is understood, there are so many things which are not understood. What is the exact trade-off? How many warning signals does the Gobi give per hour? How many, you know, potential, you know, attempted predation attempts per hour are there? What's the rate of digging for the Gobi? So what's the trade-off here? You know, how much digging work for how much guard duty. There are other, you know, so basically this really touches upon how well does the visual perception of small fish work in different environments. We have here, this we did at 18 meters, so we have deep sides, we have shallow sides, and there are two species of shrimp gobies which are quite common in Bali now. So we also have two different species. I think there's a lot of really interesting biology to be done with this symbiosis. And at the PAMS meeting, I was lucky and I met Professor Bosna Weil from UB Computer Science, who has developed a very sophisticated system to analyze fish movement. So I'm giving him the fish videos and then I get the traces back, I get statistics of all the movements back. So, you know, not only I think there's really interesting observations we can make, but we also have quite sophisticated ways of analyzing them now. So if you're interested in that, email me, easy to find them. If you Google me, or Patrick can give you my email address, or talk to me after the talk. It'd be nice to have somebody who is carrying this on until I hopefully come back. So thank you everybody at UPMSI, and thanks to these people. So these are the people from People at the Sea. And Clint Barrett is now at the University of Reading in the UK. And all these others are still up in Madapascua. If you happen to be in Madapascua, drop by in the so-called barrio. Everybody knows them, that they do interesting work. And thank you. Are very effective in many cases. The spines are not just sticking out there, often they will bundle. So if you're coming from this side, you can't really see very well, you know, what exactly is coming, but it realizes that there's a dark object here. It would move the spines in this direction. In many cases, some of these pericillaria are highly poisonous. So we found, you know, the flower urchin, the one with the discs, we found a report by a Japanese researcher in the 30s who said he touched one and then he had a really hard time breathing and speaking for 6 hours. So, you know, some of them are quite poisonous. And, you know, the coral rubble is just a mechanical barrier against predation. We are speculating that the seagrass might be something like an olfactory camouflage, like a masking agent, basically. So there are really a couple of layers which had. We have these huge marine snakes which prey on them. And what they do, I mean, you've seen it, I actually still haven't seen it. They have this proboscis, which then goes in between the spines, and it's probably chemical, right? That it etches through this armor, the tests, and then it just sucks out the inside. Yeah.
Okay, more questions?
I think I will think of the sea urchin in a very different manner now. So I wonder if these are preserved in the geologic record as well, this hovering behavior.
That's a good idea to look at that, you know. I mean, there is, of course, because they form this hard skeleton that is a fantastic paleontological record for sea urchins, but I wonder whether that is preserved, yeah? So you would have to look for different statistics of rock around the urchins versus empty rock, right? You know, I do a literature study, and I haven't come across that, but that's a very interesting point. So it would be, you know, according to this tree, it would be in the Triassic that this evolved first. Thank you. Good suggestion.
Okay, more questions?
You mentioned earlier that different species utilize different materials to cover themselves. Do you think the availability of material matters? If plastics are available, they can they cover themselves?
Very much, yeah. I mean, we found a lot of, kopiko, charcoal, sachets, true. Which is, on the one hand, it's sad, right? But on the other hand, this is ideal. Because it's highly UV blocking and very light. And there is one study from the Caribbean where they essentially looked at a seagrass bed versus coral rubber. And while the urchins have a preference for certain covering materials, they also take their non-preferred material if their first choice is not there. So, I'm not, if that's on my list to check what is the factor which they use to choose. And I think it could either just be weight, or, I mean, this, as I said in the introduction, these 2 feet have chemical sensors. So they might be able to tell that this is seagrass. And there was one study where they gave them translucent plastic chips and black plastic chips, and they prefer the black ones. So, this again points towards UV protection. So I guess they would also, move them on top of themselves, and then if the light level doesn't drop, they would discard them. So, there were some other interesting behaviors. The long spine urchins, the diademas, so basically in this study I would take these barbecue prongs and take off all the covering material, and then immediately they would start loading. Sometimes there was no proper material, and then they would run underneath the diadema. So, where it's also safe. Which again points more to a function as anti-predatory behavior.
More questions?
Is it protection from UV or protection from heat?
It's UVB, it seems. At least, this was done in, I think it's a Caribbean relative of one of the ones we looked at. And they had them in a tank, and they had aquarium lights, and it, you know, specifically the UVB, the short wavelength UV. Yeah, so basically the thing is, if you find a dead urchin, you get this calcified gill. But that is actually an endoskeleton. So the skin of the urchin is on the outside. So they're really quite sensitive. And then, you know, I mean, if you're out on the boat, right, here, even for a couple of hours, you still feel it, you really feel it on your skin, and they would be constantly exposed to that. And 2 meters of water doesn't do much yet in terms of UV protection. There's one report where they found urchins with covering material in a few hundred meters with a submersible. So that would clearly not be for UV protection. So you know that this behavior clearly has at least 3 or 4 different purposes. But yeah, in terms of UV, it's UVB.
Why don't they just go deeper instead of covering themselves?
Because the food is shallow. They're grazing.
Can they hide under a rock?
Yeah.